undergraduate degree from Johns Hopkins University and worked for several years as a research assistant at the University of Haifa. He completed his PhD in ecology and evolution from SUNY at Stony Brook, and then did a postdoc at the University of California, Riverside. He is presently a faculty member and associate chair of the Department of Biological Sciences at Wayne State University. So Ed, you can begin your presentation.
Thank you, Heather, and it's a pleasure to be here and to speak to all of you. Thank Heather for that great introduction. She will update my whole seminar, so we can almost jump to questions. But I have to say, I know that most of you are working from the management point of view and have a lot of field experience. I'm recalling the story of the molecular biologist was at a conference and then was driving around afterwards and saw this beautiful pastoral view of the sheep on the hillside and was kind of transfixed by it. And as he's staring out there, the shepherd, the farmer came up to him and asked him what he was doing, and he said that he just loved the view and he was just loved looking at the sheep. And then he said, you know what? How about that? If I can guess, if I'm looking how many sheep there are out there, can I take one? And sure. So the guy looks at him and says, yeah, 487 sheep. You're absolutely right. Can you go ahead and choose the lamb if there's one you want? So he goes out to the field and picks up a small animal after looking around and choosing one he wanted most. He walks back to the farmer and the farmer says, you know what, I'll make a second guess if you want. I'll say, you know, if I can guess your occupation, I get the animal back. And the molecular biologist is the same. He says, well, if you're a bench molecular biologist, he's kind of related. Sure, how did you know that? He said, well, first give me my dog back, and then I'll tell you how I do it. So, again, I'm not quite that bad, but I know that I'm talking more people who have expertise in what Phragmites does and the basic reasons in general. But we will start with just some thoughts, not to tell you anything that you don't know, but really to kind of get you focused on how I'm thinking of ways to approach the problem. So Phragmites, as with most invasive species, is successful because of its competitive advantage over native species. In fact, Phragmites displays a number of life history traits that gives it its advantage. So first of all, it does have a high seed output and has a small seed size, leading to both distributions and also to producing a seed bank that can remain present for quite a while. The second thing is it has a rapid growth and an upright structure. And this then gives it competitive advantages over other species in the area, so that therefore it can come to compete for sunlight and therefore replace other species. And then the third aspect is that it has an extensive vegetative reproduction that is mediated by its extensive rhizome and root growth. Therefore, it can capture an area and then spread by vegetative reproduction. So right now, the question is, you know, if Phragmites is King Kong in this drawing here, the question is, who are we or where are we? Are we the people in the biplanes there that are pretty much ineffectively peppering King Kong, or are we in King Kong's grasp right now? So what we have to do then is look at Phragmites from the point of view of its competitive advantage and look at developing new tools or, if you will, new arsenal to try to control it. And in general, I like to present then gene silencing as a potential for controlling Phragmites. And also, I do want to emphasize that if we can get this working in Phragmites, in principle, we can get this to work any invasive species. There's quite a bit of hope and excitement about this.
Hey, Ed, I'm going to interrupt you for a moment. We are having some background noise. I know some people just joined us. If you can hit star 6 to mute your phone, that would be appreciated. Thank you.
I'd also like to repeat what Heather stated earlier. If you have any questions, please do write them in the chat panel. I'll be happy to try to address it as best I can at the end of the discussion. I'll hopefully keep this short, around 35 minutes or so, until we'll have plenty of time for discussion. So then, we've talked about in gene silencing, but what is it and what is the kind of the history? How do we understand what it is? Really, it's a fairly new phenomenon that we have an understanding of. It was first actually identified in plants with working with Petunia, and then it was called at that time PTGS, which is post-transcriptional gene silencing. It's also been identified in almost all eukaryotes since that initial identification of it, and it's very frequently referred to as RNAi or RNA interference. The most important thing about it is that it is triggered in eukaryotic cells by double-stranded RNA. Now, you may recall from your introductory biology classes that RNA is produced as a single-stranded molecule, and usually it's active in the form of a single-stranded molecule, as opposed to DNA, which is always found in double-stranded form. But RNA can be found in double-stranded structures, either in some viruses during replication processes, or even in normal RNAs, because RNAs can fold back on themselves into complementary structures. The normal form of the double-stranded RNA that triggers gene silencing in organisms falls under two general categories. One is called siRNAs, and the second one is called miRNAs. And they more or less differ really in their origins. We need some papers on how people discuss them. siRNAs are usually very long double-stranded molecules, and usually are coming from some exogenous source outside of the cell. So normally that we usually see this as viruses. The miRNAs, as opposed to that, are actually formed by the cell itself. It's transcribed from a genic region within the genome. It forms then a hairpin structure by folding back on itself and forms a kind of a very common stem loop structure where the complementary bases form in the stem and then the uncomplementary regions intervening that region form a loop. Now, these then trigger a natural and a common mechanism in these organisms. And the mechanism itself is thought to have evolved initially as a defense against RNA viruses. It's since apparently been evolving into also mechanisms where the cell can use microRNAs to control the development of proteins and therefore control developmental stages or response to environmental cues in a very rapid fashion. So if you think about this from the cell's point of view or the organism's point of view, the organism wants to control the information that it's using to produce the phenotype that it needs at that point in time. And there are multiple ways in which a cell can do that. Of course, there's the number of copies of the gene on the genomic level. There is the rate at which a gene that is transcribed and making the messenger RNA. There's the rate at which the messenger RNA is translated into proteins, and then there are also modifications of proteins. The use of microRNAs in gene silencing, then, is an additional level that comes usually in between the transcriptional process. putting that messenger RNA before it is translated. Now, to give you an example of how this works, and maybe I'll remind people if you could put your phones on mute or hit star 6, that would be helpful. So this next slide will give you a cartoon of how this works. We'll first look at this from the point of view of the siRNA, or the short interfering RNA. If you think about a cell, from here it's a big blue blob, and an RNA virus attacking that cell, what normally happens is that the virus then injects into the cell its genome. In the case of RNA viruses, it injects then a single strand of RNA. Now, during the process of replication, the virus will normally make a double-stranded RNA molecule. This is the actual target then of the control or the regulatory system of the cell. The cell recognizes the double-stranded RNA and figures out this is something that we don't want. This is something that's normally not in the cell. And then it triggers then the response by bringing in a number of proteins. In plants, these are called Zeiser-like proteins, and these act as nucleases. So they attach on and attack then the double-stranded RNA and digest them. And they digest them in a very controlled fashion in which they'll cut up small double-stranded units of the double-stranded RNA. And these small double-stranded units are between 21 to 23 nucleotides long. The size of them actually does make a difference. They can trigger different kinds of responses. But I won't get into that aspect right now. But generally, what you can see by this is you have gotten rid of your double-stranded RNA and now have these small RNA double-stranded molecules around. Now, these small double-stranded 21 nucleotide-based fragments then are incorporated into a protein complex which is called RIP, or the RNA-induced silencing complex. When it enters into this protein complex, the double-stranded RNA unwinds, and only one of the strands, called the guide strand, remains in the complex. Now, this guide strand is actually complementary to the initial viral RNA. And so what happens then is that the complex with the guide RNA then attaches on by complementarity of the bases in the guide RNA to the bases that are in its target sequence. And that can be the viral RNA as shown here, or it could be a messenger RNA. And the neat thing about it, the thing that we can really use, is that it is based on exact complementarity. We can find that it's true. So you can design then specific regions that would match then the specific sequence of your target, and that same sequence would be then ineffective if you're looking at a different species or a different sequence that is off by a series of nucleotides. Once the RIS complex matches up with its target template sequence, then it triggers then one of the subunits of that complex to actually digest the target RNA. That leads then to the degradation of that RNA, and of course then that has the effect on the phenotype. So if we look at this in terms of the microRNAs, the mechanisms are very, very similar. The only major difference is that the initial trigger for the double-stranded RNA is actually coming from the nucleus itself. As you can see, but if you look at about 11 o'clock on the drawing, you see a double-stranded hairpin structure that's coming out from the nucleus. This is then identified by a Zeiser-like protein, which then digests this structure, leaving your 21 nucleotide fragment. This goes into the risk, and again, attack through messenger RNA. So this, the process is pretty much identical between siRNAs and microRNAs. So for us then, what we would like to do is to trigger these processes in our target species and use them to control growth. So this next slide, which actually I have to thank Les Pitchford for putting together for me, kind of illustrates this idea. If you start with them on your normal plant and realize that the processes that are leading to its growth, such as photosynthesis, its development as homeotic genes, the elongation of the roots, et cetera, they're all being controlled by genes that are in the genome that are being turned on at a specific time. And if you remember your basic molecular biology dogma that we go from a gene, we transplant a gene, and we make a messenger RNA that is then transported to the cytoplasm, and then in the cytoplasm that messenger RNA is translated into a protein, then that protein gives the effect of causing the phenotype that you want, and then in this case, the plant will grow and survive and lead to reproduction as shown here. Now, if we take the same paradigm and say, all right, let's introduce into our target species a gene in a transient fashion, in other words, not making transgenic organisms, we'll find something that will create a double-stranded RNA. That double-stranded RNA then is designed to match up the sequence of our target gene. It is transcribed in the plant, and then it is recognized by the ricer enzyme, which cuts it. It then makes a small piece of RNA that attacks the messenger RNA and leads to the degradation of the messenger RNA. Obviously, when messenger RNA is gone, there's nothing to translate, and the protein disappears, and therefore it has a phenotypic effect of having a gene knockdown. So it's almost as if you're mutating the gene. And indeed, these kinds of approaches are used to study gene activity in place of generating mutants. So our goal then is to use gene silencing to control invasive species. So we're going to be obviously focusing on Phragmites as our first target species. So our goal then, to repeat, is to develop a robust mode to cause transient generation of the double-stranded RNA into Phragmites. Now, we have to, while doing that, also think of means by which we can apply this to Phragmites as individual plants and eventually in the field. We have to then, if you look at the genes that we'd like to target, these include genes for photosynthesis, which allow for biomass production, for flower development, which can lead to sexual reproduction and production of seeds, and obviously root development, which is involved in this species, especially in asexual reproduction. We want to be able to develop a reliable and effective gene silencing that will last over time and produce the phenotypic effects that we want, and particularly look for our ability to cause a reduction in the competitive balance of Phragmites. Our basic idea behind this is not to kill the plant. We do not want to cause dead zones. We're not trying to produce herbicides. What we want to do is we want to cripple the plant so that we can have native species become reintroduced and outcompete the Phragmites, so that we can have a semi-natural reclamation of natural communities. Now, to do the actual development of our double-stranded RNA, there are three basic means that have been used in plants that really generate the RNA in different kinds of vectors. The first general kind is called a viral induced gene silencing, called VIGS. The second kind is to use vectors that will produce hairpin structures when they are transcribed. They can be similar double-stranded RNA that I showed you before. And then a third mechanism is kind of refinement of the second one, which is to create artificial microRNAs, or AMIRs. So let me give you some examples of some of the things that we've done and are doing now inside Phragmites. So first of all, my lab had worked with our VIGS approach, a virally induced approach, which is work I've done previously in spinach. We generated a novel vector, which is derived from a deep curly top virus, which we disarmed, and then used to silence the genes. And on the right, you can see examples of two leaves, one from a control treated plant, and one from a plant that was treated with a gene that would silence a photosynthetic pathway gene. And you can see that the leaf becomes bleach. Another example of this, and using the same kind of vector, is you can attack homeotic genes. There's genes that are involved in general development of complex organs in an organism. And so here you see an example of using a gene that's involved in soil development. So you see on your left a flower, I'm sure that all of you recognize, probably have bouquets in at home. This is a spinach female flower. So spinach plants actually have both male plants versus female plants and dioecious. And this is an example of a flower defining on a female plant. So it's kind of reduced. It has just two sepals, has no petals. It doesn't produce any stamens and just has a central pistil. You can see the stigma sticking out. Now, by treating our plant with a gene that's involved in creating reproductive structures and also terminates the meristem of the flower, you see on the right what you end up with. And what happens is that the flower then regresses to the primitive state. So you see all the organs on the flower then don't differentiate, but become what is the original organ from which flowers developed, which are little leaves. In fact, you see the cyclones on these leaves. Also, you see that this gene is involved in terminating the flower. So you see this kind of continuous development of whorls of leaves and phylotactic development. Now, we can also attack this with other genes. So on the right, you see now a male spinach flower. It has four stamens and four sepals. No pistil whatsoever, and again, no petals in it. And on the right, you see then a plant that was treated for a different gene, and this then causes the loss of the same development that allows for the development of a central pistil. So you see four sepals and then a central pistil. So again, a homeotic transformation. Another example of homeotic transformation here again in the female flower. If you look on the right, you'll see one female flower that has normal two sepals and a central pistil. And then right next to it, you see a flower that has two sepals. Instead of having that central pistil, you transform it into a stamen. You can see by hitting these different genes, you can cause great changes in development. So in general, this can be a very, very powerful tool. And here's one where we change them. This normal dioecious spinach, and we had it revert to essentially an ancestral state. It's now a hermaphrodite, you see on the right. So now, what are we doing with the Phragmites project? Well, we're trying, first of all, to use and develop new VIGs or virally induced silencing. And to do so, in the lab, we're using maize as a surrogate for the Phragmites. It's a lot easier to germinate than the Phragmites. It grows quickly. It's really nice to use to begin with. And obviously, it's a grass, too, so it's kind of a pot. And so what you see here is some early work that we were doing. We developed a new vector. This is derived from the maize And so we're also looking at developing other vectors. This next slide just shows them some use of a vector that was actually designed and developed in Germany. This is a vector that forms what's called the hairpin structure. And here again, we're using maize, and we're trying to knock down a gene that's involved in photosynthesis. And we're getting some good results. Here, this is an example when it works. You can see that we have a plant that was silenced for photosynthetic gene that reduced the rate of growth compared to the control plant next to it. Again, we're pursuing this still on the side now because the length of the genes you put in these are very large. You can have off-target effects. And also, we're having issues with penetrance. We want to get a larger percentage of the plants that we're working on having an effect. So to kind of address some of those problems, the idea of the off-target effects, we're now developing vectors that are using these artificial microRNA. And this cartoon gives you an idea of the process of how you use artificial microRNA. So on the left in the drawing, you see then a structure of what would be an artificial microRNA. Think of this as an RNA molecule, and it forms this small hairpin structure, a stem loop structure that I spoke about before. On one side of the stem, you'll have the actual microRNA that is going to act as that charging sequence that will go into the wrist. And then the other side is called the MIR star, the complementary sequence that gets thrown out. So the idea is then to develop DNA vectors that can be transcribed, but to replace then just the regions of the microRNA. So we go from the red sequence to the blue sequence. We leave the rest of it all the same. And by putting in the blue sequence for particular genes and particular sequences, you're going to be 21 nucleotides long, you can get a high degree of specificity. So the advantage of these is that you can use these to trigger the normal processes that are used in the genome. In it. You can use these to regulate genes that are involved in expression, and just trigger the same kind of effect that the plant is going to be using, and therefore will not get away with not using it because it uses for its normal development. So by using them in small sequences, we can then get the ability to design targets that are very specific for very specific genes, and also perhaps at the species level, and perhaps even on the clonal level. So here's some examples of some early results we're having. Again, this is a maize plant that's been treated with artificial microRNA to reduce some of the photosynthetic properties. You can see the yellowing of the leaves. Here you see a number of plants on the left that were treated. You can see them show they are more yellow than the plants that are on the right. You can see at the same time with the control vector. We're ramping this up now in greenhouse experiments, and we're trying to move this into competition experiments. So we're using the second surrogate species that you're seeing here, which are sunflowers. So these are nice second species to use along with the maize. They are obviously easy to germinate. They grow very quickly. They can be tall plants. Then there will be a nice kind of competitive mixed crop of maize and sunflowers. So of course we want to design a balanced experiment. So we are at the same time now developing artificial microRNAs for the sunflowers. And here's some results that we have, some early results. These are using an artificial microRNA approach. This is a gene that is in the gibberellic acid synthesis pathway will affect the rates of growth. And the plants on the left with the white labels, those are control plants. The plants on the right are our treatment plants. You can see here about a third of them, the two in the front, show nice response to the treatment. But again, we're still working on this problem of how to apply these, how to get the larger percentage of the population to be affected. So in other words, again, this is a problem of penetrance and receptivity if you look at it in a genetic sense. So we are, at the same time, working on Phragmites, so we're starting to develop some genes for an artificial microRNA in Phragmites in our greenhouse. And this table is really just to give you an idea that we're trying to develop multiple genes, multiple targets at the same time. You'll see a listing for the vectors and the constructs we're putting together for sunflower columns by those are made. And you can see on the bottom then the number of those that we're now developing for the Phragmites. I particularly want to point out just one thing, and if you look in the second column when we talk about the genes, we just look at the Phragmites at the bottom. You'll notice that we're looking at two genes. One is PDS, pyrene desaturase, and the other one is GH3 oxidase, which is the last step in the active glucose acid development cycle. So notice that next to it, I say that we're getting that the sequences are derived from the transcriptome. And that's part of the work that, again, I'd like to thank our funding agency, USDS, for giving us the ability to work on it. So we're working now on transferring these technologies to Phragmites. And the first step is identifying the genetic code for particular traits in the Phragmites. There's not a lot of genes available in the gene bank right now. So we have developed our own transcriptome. So we are sequenced then the transcribed genes from four different tissue types, leads, inflorescences, meristemic regions coming off of the roots, and then the roots themselves. And we have been able to identify multiple genes of interest, as I just showed you before. Working with this data set has been a learning experience, to say the least. It's a new tool for me, analyzing the large amounts of data. But you can see here on this slide the amount of data that we are generating. So we have essentially 32 million base pairs that we've identified from inflorescence sequences or there versus the different amounts that are found in the different tissue types and the shared amounts. We've started now to identify what these genes are, so here you can get a general idea of what genes are coming from the chloroplast, which are shown in red, which are coming from mitochondria, and which are mostly nuclear-mediated genes. And as you can see from the leaf material on the lower right, very large amount of the transcriptome genes are being transcribed are coming from the chloroplast. These are the organs that are working for the plant to produce the carbon through photosynthesis, not at all surprising that we're seeing this kind of thing. And the slide that I'll put in here right now is that some of the genes we're looking at, which don't fall off, when I started looking through what they are, actually don't turn up these plant genes at all. We take with tissue from the environment and you pick up genes that are actually fungal genes. And I think that's going to be important when we start looking at other aspects. And Kurt Walsh here from USPS is kind of nodding because he is involved also in some collaborative work with someone in this project who's looking at endoplasm. So it's important to know that the transcriptomes are important on a community level. And as I'll mention again, we should start looking at this not only as a community on the plant, but community in the sense that you all are looking at. Now, another way of analyzing this data, just again very quickly, is to look at the differential expression. And so what this chart actually shows you is how one can kind of analyze the data very briefly, if you look at it, we have four tissue types that are shown down the bottom of the creating the four columns. First one is the inflorescence, the flowers, the second is the leaf tissue, the third is the meristemal tissue, and the fourth is the root. And then you get different patterns. So if you look at the pattern one for the bottom, all in blue, this means there's no differential expression. The gene that you're looking at is now easily expressed in all different tissues. As opposed to that pattern one, you see that the root would be a different color, meaning that there's a differential expression of the gene in the root versus in all other three tissues. Now, why this is important is this, we can identify then perhaps good target species, target genes rather, to attack. So again, this table shows the different number of transcripts and tics that we found in the different regions there. And I'd like to point out to you that if you look at number 8, pattern number 8, you have 48,000 transcripts that were found in this pattern. And you see at the bottom, pattern 8 really shows the F, which is the flower or inflorescence, is different from the leaf, the American root that are shown together in parentheses. So those are all the same, and the flower, these are going to be then small specific genes. So in other words, I'm looking at genes that are you're not finding in the genome, they're all in the genome, but they're expressed in the different tissue. And in fact, those are the things we want to collect. And so going through these exercises actually has been very important. Now, once we get the genes that we want, we can attack them for silencing. And the different expression patterns in this kind of analysis perhaps could also be used to look for different genotypes, different clones within a species. So this is stretching it a bit, I'll say at this point in time, but conceptually at least, perhaps we can actually even look at differences between native versus invasive species, not only in terms of the sequence, but also in the expression numbers. And then obviously by creating this, this is creating a database that we hope to have out soon for the community as a whole. Now, why am I so excited by this I put it down here that gene silencing, I think, for managers might be a holy grail. It's not going to be the only thing that you're going to be using. It's going to be used, it will have to be used in general management programs. But this work that we're doing is going to show that we can use gene silencing as a viable management or control option for invasive species. And by using very specific silencing vectors, we can then go into native mixed plant communities and do widespread applications by knowing that we're targeting the genes of only very specific species and it will be ineffective in other species. And again, if you can look at this in terms of even genotype specific effects, we can even look at between native versus invasive phragmites. And this is going to be true of other species too. So the idea behind this, again, is not to decimate or to kill large patches of invasive species, but rather to control them, to knock them down, to make them less aggressive so that the native environment, the native communities can then replace them and come in. Now, are we there yet? No, we're not. We still, as I've shown you, we have problems getting better penetrance and expressivity of the microRNAs and Phragmites or in other species. We're actually going to be starting this spring looking at another invasive species from the Great Lakes region. So we'll be hoping to move on to that early. Then there's going to be the question from a management point of view, what's going to be the persistence of the silencing vector itself? Remember, we're not creating transgene plants. These are treatments that will go into a cell and cause then a temporary expression of our silencing vector. Will the vectors spread throughout the plant? That depends on which vector we're using. And we're looking now at doing larger vectors. If I might just mention, if those of you are listening, could you hit your mute button or star 6 so we don't hear you? I'm almost done, though, so no worries. And then the next part is how do we get the motive application? So when we move it to the field, mechanistically, how are we going to do this? Are we going to be using an agrobacterium means for doing this, or are we going to do it using a biolistic approach? These both approaches in the laboratory. And then finally, what are going to be the guidelines and, of using gene silencing within going back to the metaphor we used earlier, the arsenal that you managers are using at the present time. This can then be part of something that is already being used or in addition to, and something that's going to have to be planted. But again, I want to try to communicate my advice something about this. I really do think that this is big. This is not only about Phragmites. This could be effective for any invasive plant. We can look at this as potential, really, game changer. This could be a huge breakthrough to looking at invasive species management and restoration of natural communities. So I want to end just by thanking everyone who's helped me quite a bit in this project. So from USPS and the Great Lakes Science Center in Ann Arbor, I want to thank Chris Walty, who's my handler, we'll call him. And then Wes Bickford, who's been really very, very helpful to me. And then also the support that I've been getting from Russ, from the GLS group. And also from GLC, I want to thank Heather, Ron, for inviting me, and Elizabeth for helping organize this. And then at Wayne State, my good friend and colleague, Howard Freeman, is an ecologist, been very helpful in thinking about this project. And then people in my lab itself, previous technicians, Dr. Subashini and Dendron, who was a plant pathologist and helped quite a bit in beginning developing things big. My present technician, who also has computer skills, which has been very helpful. And some of the students in my lab, James Nager and Nick West, who are both graduate students. And I have two exceptional undergraduate students who are working with me now, Lamont Wilkin, who's doing some of the analysis of the sequences, and then Umar Ahmed, who is doing a lot of the greenhouse work with treating the plants. So I want to end by thanking the USPS for the support of this project, and I'm open for any questions that you may have.
Thank you, Ed. Really great presentation on a very complicated subject. We do have some questions coming in. The first one I want to ask about is risk, the risk that viruses can mutate in nature and infect other plant varieties outside the target. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Right. So the risk here with using these different vectors are their ability to both mutate and to spread. When we're looking at using the virally-induced gene silencing approaches, these are modified viruses. So, for example, with the B. trillicop virus, I removed completely the coat protein and the movement protein. So it cannot really move except from cell to cell. And what we did in our studies in developing that vector, we looked to see if there's any evidence of the vector itself even moving through the plant. And we found no evidence of that. But we did find evidence of the silencing signal, the F ion that was moving through the plant. The important thing is to design the vector so that not only can they not reproduce themselves, but that if they can reproduce within a cell, but they can't move. The plasmids can reproduce and they copy for themselves, but the virus cannot make these exposed proteins. The other thing that we looked at that I was concerned about was that if there was a native virus in the plant, could it be combined? And again, what we did is we designed it so that any recombination that would be viable could only reproduce the virus that was in the plant at the time, but could not produce a changed virus. Now, in terms of mutations, again, you're not looking at something that is replicating outside of the plant, so it doesn't have any issues right now. There was a study that was done looking at gene silencing through the EPA, and what they considered that there was nothing that was unique about this approach. And even they were looking at systems that were looking at transgenic types, and we're not looking at that at all. We were transgenic.
So, Ed, if gene silencing is not passed on to generation, how does it affect the overall population? Do we need to treat continually?
Yeah, that's an excellent point. I think we do want to design this so that we have to have multiple applications. So hopefully what we can do, we haven't gotten to this stage just because of the difficulty of looking at the phenotype, but we want to be able to reduce not only the growth rate, but also the reproductive speed. Now, if we do that, obviously that is not going to affect any seed that's in the seed bank. And so you'll constantly have this ability of the seed to come back. Now, I think many of the managers here will be nodding and saying, yeah, you know, we burned out everything in the field, and all of a sudden we get this new growth coming back out from the seed bank. So any treatment that we're doing will have to be part of a management program. This may be also in terms of even within a growing season that we perhaps have to do multiple applications. These are very important questions that we don't have with answers. We're aware of them, we're thinking about them. There are some of the things that we're doing in the greenhouse now, testing between single applications and multiple applications. But when we get to the field, especially when we start talking about management, I think that's going to be an issue that simply you have to empirically derive. Mm-hmm. Kirsty, have anything to add?
Well, on that note, maybe we can talk a little bit about application and what, you know, we have stands of frags that are small, stands of frags that are hundreds of acres. What is your vision at this point for application?
The application, I think, is scalable. So right now, we have two means of applying the vectors to the plant. One is using agrobacterium, the other one is using biological growth. Both of these have aspects to them that have to be tested in the field. What is the persistence of agrobacterium in the field? What is the rate of spread? If it rains, does it move in the field? These are all things that have to be tried under controlled conditions or limited conditions in the field before we can address that. The other approach that we've been using, the biolistic approach, briefly is you produce a powder of these punchy particles, these fine particles, you coat them with the vector that you use in the DNA, and you essentially spray or shoot the plant. And the particles are small enough that they enter into the cell and then it releases the DNA. Now, if you do that, what about the persistence of the metal in the area? Again, it's something that needs to be addressed once we get to a field situation. Now, in terms of the mechanistic problem of actively applying them, I view that as the lesser of the problem. If we're using agrobacterium, you simply have a solution, you can spray them. If it's a matter of using biolistics, right now we have a gene gun in the laboratory, and if you simply use air or even helium to expel the particles, this can simply be scaled up. I think it's an engineering problem, and not an environmental problem, they're biological. No. But the other two aspects are potential things to look at. That is, how long does the people last? How long does the agrobacterium last? What would be the effect of using biological?
So high target site specificity herbicides have been linked to more rapid evolution resistance. Is this a concern with RNA as well?
Potentially. The difference here is that you're looking at a target site. So the RNA that is used is used to a specific sequence. Could you have variations in the population in that specific sequence? The answer is yes. But again, what we would like to do is create a cocktail of vectors that we'd be applying at the same time. These can then can attach different genes and within the same gene in multiple sites, which then reduces the ability of the plant to evolve very quickly. The other aspect is that you're not producing something that is itself going to be passed on from generations. Is there a potential that a vector, let's say we use some of the vectors that we're using right now, that they can get into a plant genome? Yeah, some of these, the agrobacterium vectors can get into the genome, but they cannot spread to the meristemic tissue. That is, they'll be locked in. If you apply to leaves, they're locked in to leaves. The leaves don't develop into flowers. Only meristemic tissue develops into flowers. So again, there's very little chance of them escape. Evolution happens all the time, mutation happens all the time, so it's just like treating any other kind of disease. We don't use just one antibiotic. We don't use one anti-AIDS drug.
All right, now kind of a multi phase question here. The first is about legalization hurdles to operationalizing this in the field, the timeline for operationalizing the field, and also if there's any idea at this point about the cost of this sort of product.
Do you want to first talk about the legalization, because we've just discussed briefly the concept. We would have to obviously go through EPA. EPA has looked at aspects and mentioned a study about doing silencing in general in the plant population and agriculture system. I'm not sure of anything else.
Yeah, I'll just offer that. I think that's another line of work that needs to be done. Because this is such a new technology in this application that there's going to be a whole suite of learning that needs to go on with regulators and learning what needs to be done to make sure that this technology not just is effective and we'll think it's going to be done, but it's safe. It's something that should be used. So we're already starting with early discussions with folks and thinking about that very downstream type of question. Get something, then how might it be applied to the field, and what regulatory angle might come into it. So we're thinking about that. I think it's quite a long ways away, but our approach is to try to work the science at the same time of talking to folks about understanding the technology, thinking through that.
To also address money in the field and the cost. I hope you see that we're working still quite a bit in the developmental phase of this. We have to do competition experiments with controls in the greenhouse before we get to the field. We are hoping, perhaps, next growing season to have a very limited trial in a field setting. That is our goal. Now, in terms of cost, I think ultimately the major cost for any kind of application is going to be in development. That is, if you have a new species or a new community, I think first of all we'll have to invest money into getting community level genome or transcriptome community. Using them, once you have those developed, that you're applying them to the field, I don't think will be a very costly process. If we continue using vectors that are generated by plasmids, we can grow these in large numbers, large amounts, quantities of these in E. coli, and then isolate them out. It's a very cheap way. It's not as if you're generating a herbicide that has a lot of chemistry involved in it. Just nothing. So I think once you have them designed for your target, gearing it up for field application should not be that expensive. It might be overly optimistic, but I really can't see that that's going to be a limited effect.
And we are just at 2 o'clock now, and I know some people are signing up, but I think there's just another couple questions here. Do you have a site for your field trials? And are you looking for more sites?
The answer is no sites have been picked. However, all their ideas out there, and you know, they're about to drag around, but not the things go into picking a field site. So if they offer some feedback, we have ideas and we're going to have that discussion.
Great. Are there any other questions, Fred? All right. Well, I think we have most of the ones that were called in about. I first want to thank Ed for a great presentation. This is a really interesting stretch of science, and I think all of us would prefer at this point to do a little less herbicide, try something new, to try to get beyond just dealing with our stands of frag. So I want to thank everyone for participating in the call today. The webinar was recorded, and you'll be able to find that and a copy of the presentation on the Great Lakes Phragmites Collaborative website, hopefully within the next couple of days. So, goodbye and have a great day.